Good morning, everybody. It's lovely to see you all, so thank you all for coming. Just a few reminders. We've got the light party on Monday evening. Obviously, that's for the children. Non-scary costumes. fireworks night will be on the Friday, 4th of November, 6:30. And if you need a ticket, Tanya should be selling them. So she should be here at the end of this service, start of the next one. All soul services next Sunday. They'd like you to make a cake if you could. 3 o'clock, so we can offer out tea and cake after the service. And they're asking for, there you go, donation of cakes. Celia's offering an Advent retreat on the 12th of November. I can't go to that one, so that's me out. And there's a couple of other things there. Christmas hampers looks like it's going well because there's more pink tickets than white. So that means everyone's picked up a card and the hampers will be made. So thank you all for your generosity. And with my Christmas hat on, Christmas fair's coming up. Any donations, can you bring them into the church and put them right at the back? And I will try and get through them before the day. Father Christmas has been booked, so he will be arriving. It is, you're quite right. So if you come down for 6:30 communion on Wednesday, you'll be waiting an hour. But if you come down at 7:30, you'll be on time. Right, okay, that's for the All Souls. So there's quite a bit on All Souls. We've got Sunday, 6 o'clock, 6th of November at 3 o'clock. We've got Wednesday evening, 7:30. And anybody that can help at All Souls to take out teas and coffees and make sure everybody's okay. Christmas hat back on. Please bring your donations in. Enid phoned me last night and she wants to do a plant stall. Now, she won't be at church today because they're at Southwark, but she said, can you bring in some pot plants? I'm not sure whether she wants the pot or plants in them. So if you could do a bit of both, that'd be great. Because it was a bit vague. And yes, so I think that's us for now. Thank you very much for your patience. Do enjoy your service. We'll start with prayer.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Please be seated. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to our service for All Saints' Day. Today we give thanks for all the saints who surround us like a great cloud of witnesses. It begins that season of the church's year when we are reminded that there is another world besides and beyond this one. Especially we remember less famous saints and that host of ordinary Christians who in their day faithfully loved and served their Lord.
We acknowledge that unlike God's choice saints, we are just average disciples, seldom very evil, rarely very loving. We make our way through the streets and businesses of life, and at times along lonely byways. Too often we skirt around the obstacles of evil rather than challenge their existence. We read of the saints and feel uplifted and for a few hours inspired to reach higher. We remember loved ones whose faithfulness once lit our path and whose steadfast love warmed our hearts.
The Lord delights in saving those who need help. Having heard and believed the word of truth, the gospel of salvation, we have been sealed with the Holy Spirit as the pledge of our redemption. Sisters and brothers, your sins are forgiven for his sake. Be at peace.
Amen.
Amen.
We will.
Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Christ our Lord. Grant us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those inexpressible joys which you have prepared for those who truly love you, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the church at Ephesus. In Christ, we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance towards redemption as God's own people, to the praise of his glory. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love towards all the saints. And for this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power. God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet, and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus looked up at his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven. For that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets. But I say to you that listen, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from anyone who takes away your coat, do not withhold even your shirt. Give to everyone who begs from you, and if anyone takes away your goods, do not ask for them again. Do to others as you would have them do to you. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you.
Please sit down. There are certain days in the church's year that we're asked to remember, and today is one of them. Today we're remembering and celebrating All Saints' Day. It's a bit early, as All Saints' Day is the 1st of November, but this is the closest Sunday to that day. Since the earliest days of Christendom, the faithful have gathered to give thanks for the life and ministry of the saints. Women and men whose witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ has been a blessing in every generation. The witness of many of these women and men are well known. Many of their writings have become popular. Their deeds inspire us to name hospitals and schools and churches after them. And their service to the church has been taught to the faithful in every generation. Yet for others, such as Saint Simon or Jude, who were asked in the lectionary to remember from time to time, little is known about them beyond their names. But regardless of how much or how little we know about these faithful witnesses, one thing is certain: their life and ministry has truly blessed the church. As we gather to celebrate the Feast of All Saints, we're called to give thanks to God for the blessings that the saints have bestowed upon the church, as well as the many blessings God has bestowed upon us. For me, it's not just about the saints that the church names and celebrates. For me, the Feast of All Saints is summed up in that phrase, a cloud of witnesses. Remember that famous reading from Paul's letter to the Hebrews that we have sometimes. We read, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses," meaning all the saints that have gone before us. So biblically, Paul is saying in that letter to the Hebrews that the saints aren't just those that are named and we write down and remember? No, of course. Paul is addressing all Christians as saints, literally holy people, as he later writes, to the church of God which is at Corinth, with all the saints that are throughout Achaia. So if a saint is a holy person or a follower of God, are there any saints here this morning? Yes, all of us. That's a shocker, isn't it? So where Paul talks about the saints in Corinth, we are the saints in St. Mary's. We are the saints in Porchester, because we number among God's chosen people in this area. Because what makes us holy is the same God who makes all his other saints holy. So if we're part of a community of saints, then we as a church, we are a church in which God is present and makes himself known to his faithful people and through his faithful people in every generation. That continuity is the hallmark of our celebration of All Saints when we remember with gratitude all those who have gone before, who have known God and who have made God known. Back to a minute for the early saints that the church names and celebrates. Of course, by worldly standards, it would appear that the saints didn't know very much about worldly blessings. Most of them didn't know the first thing about wealth, and many lived with part of their lives or all of their lives in poverty. Status and the power that comes with it was a foreign concept to them. Many of the saints never knew high-paying or revered jobs, choosing instead to work for little or no money, serving the poor and the helpless. And far from inspiring fear or subordination, many of the saints were hated and met their untimely death precisely because of the faith that they so boldly proclaimed. But worldly standards weren't how the saints patterned their lives. They lived by Jesus's standards. And in our gospel reading from Luke this morning, Jesus's standard for what constituted a blessing is radically different from the standards that the rest of the world was accustomed to. Listen again to Luke's gospel. Blessed are you who are poor. Jesus says, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you and when they exclude you and persecute you on account of me, for surely your reward is great in heaven. Poverty, hunger, mourning, hatred, persecution, these things certainly don't seem like blessings to me, but Jesus is convinced that they are. And most shockingly of all, Jesus says these people are the sort of people to whom the kingdom of God is entrusted. Of course, some would have raised their hands in objection and said, we can't possibly entrust the kingdom of God to a bunch of people like that. They don't know the first thing about business or what it takes to run a kingdom. Yet with piercing clarity, Jesus looks straight at the opponents of the kingdom, looks at them in the eye and pronounces a stern warning, again from Luke's gospel. Woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. In other words, woe to you who don't know what poverty looks like or what hunger feels like. Woe to you who have not known an occasion for mourning, and woe to you who manage to tell everybody what they want to hear instead of the truth which they so desperately need to hear. And the kingdom of God witnessed by Jesus in the gospel is not some abstract theological term about a time and place that the world has never known. No, in fact, the kingdom of God can be a place that all of us can come to know. The kingdom of God breaks through when we love our enemies. It takes hold when we do good to those who hate us. It comes alive when we bless those who curse us. It shines brightly when we pray for those who mistreat us. Of course, the work of building the kingdom is not easy. But then again, Jesus reminds us life with God isn't easy either. Life with God may mean that we know what it's like to be poor or hungry, sorrowful and persecuted. Life with God may mean that we know what it's like to be unpopular, to be discounted or overlooked. Life with God may mean that we know what it's like to be persecuted. But the good news is that the kingdom of God has been built brick by brick, stone by stone, by people such as these, people who have known what poverty and hunger and sorrow and being cursed looks like, people who know how it feels to be overlooked or discounted, people who know what persecution feels like. There's much in the book of Revelation about the saints. The saints of God, or the cloud of witnesses, are those who stand before the throne and before God in this life and in the life to come. They're a group of ordinary people, past, present, and future, who have a close relationship with God. Make no mistake, that's you and me. In this life, they weren't perfectly sinless people, nor were they especially powerful people, but they were profoundly connected people. Men and women, through their belief in God and the forgiveness of their sins, are linked directly to God and to the Lamb, Jesus Christ. One of the elders in Revelation asks John, "Who are these robed in white? And where have they come from?" John shrugs his shoulders, so the elder answers his own question. They're not particularly the best. They're not the most successful or the most sophisticated, but instead they are the ones who have come out of the great ordeal, meaning this life. Their robes have been made white by the blood of the Lamb. Out of this great ordeal they have come. Out of the trials and temptations, distractions and interruptions. Although being pushed and pulled and sometimes pulverized by earthly events, job loss, marital problems, conflict with neighbors, etc., they have done their best to remain close to God through prayer, praise, scripture reading, and simple acts of service. They have been bloodied by life, but then washed clean in their faith in Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. They, like you, are the saints of God. So what does all this mean for us today? It means that we have been handed the baton of faith by the saints of the past. What are we going to do with it? Are we going to have a wishy-washy faith? Are we going to have a Sunday-only faith? I do hope not. It's up to us today to hold firm to that baton and to run with it and play our part, to be counted among that cloud of witnesses. It's important not to give up. A few weeks ago, Ian spoke of a woman he knew who failed her driving test 18 times. She never gave up. She kept on going. When I took my driving test a good number of years ago, something unusual happened. I knocked somebody over. I was in slow-moving traffic, and a woman stepped out in front of me, and I hit her. She fell into the road. But before we could get out the car, she got up, brushed herself down, and scurried back into the crowd. The examiner said to me, "Well, you may as well carry on." I could have given up. I felt like giving up. It all just seemed pointless, When we got back to the test centre, the examiner said, "You've passed." I sat there with my mouth open. He said, "Anybody who can knock somebody over on their driving test and carry on driving is good enough for me." I didn't give up, and neither should we when it comes to our faith. Things will distract us. Things will try and lead us astray, but let's not give up. So today, as we remember the Feast of All Saints, let us begin to live our life by a different set of standards. Instead of worldly standards, let us begin to live our life more by the standards of the kingdom. Let us remain close to God through prayer. Let us worship him, not just on a Sunday, but every day. Let us read our Bibles, and with everything within us, let's stay as close to God as we can. Let's try and be strong in our faith. And when we do that, the Blessed Communion of Saints cries out, "Alleluia, Alleluia." Amen.
In a moment, we will confess the faith of the Church in the Creed, but just to focus on the fourth line from the bottom, we believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. That's kind of what Adam has been talking about. The word Catholic in the Creed does not refer to the Roman Catholic Church. That's why it's in the small c rather than large c. The word Catholic simply means this: a church which is older than us and a church which is bigger than us. That's all it simply means. It's older than us. It goes right back to the time of the apostles, because it says the Catholic and Apostolic Church. Remember, that's not just the Catholic Church. The Catholic and Apostolic Church goes right back to the time of the apostles, many of whom we are celebrating today. And not only is it older than us, it's bigger than us. It goes throughout the whole world, and many of the saints of God have been black and brown and Chinese and all colours, all shapes, all sizes. A worldwide church. The Christian church is in every country in the world. It's even in North Korea, where they claim that there is no church and there are no Christians. There are probably 10,000 Christians even in North Korea, having to keep it quiet, obviously. So as we say the Creed today, we're joining in with a great millions of people who are saying the very same words and are identifying their connection with that which is older than us and bigger than us. So let us stand as we confess the faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray.
Lord, we thank you for the blessing of knowing your kingdom, knowing in our frailty that we need you. And Lord, there's so much in our hearts, but Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer. You know our needs before we ask. By your grace, in your abundant love, increase our faith and trust. Fill us, your church, with the healing love of Jesus. By the light of your Spirit, guide us, Lord. Teach all people to know and to follow the way of your kingdom of love and joy and peace. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We thank you, Father, for all the saints who have gone before, examples of their steadfast faith and love and service. We pray that we may respond to the call to be saints, Christ seen in us, in loving service in your name. Lord, hear us.
Lord,
we pray for Jonathan, our bishop. Give him courage, wisdom, and insight as he leads in the guidance and oversight of the affairs of this diocese. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for Ian, for all who diligently serve with him in sharing God's ministry in word and sacrament, for the whole church, here, throughout the world, in all aspects of management, service, and worship. We pray, Father, that we together here may grow united as one body, together in loving service. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously.
We pray for King Charles and all serving in his government and parliament as they confront the many issues of our nation and the wider world, including the problem of modern slavery. Give them integrity, competence, selfless courage, and wisdom serving under your guidance. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously
hear us. We pray for the nations of the world and their leaders, especially where there is war and unrest, especially at this time for the people of Ukraine and Iran, and for protection from the ongoing wars, violence, oppression, and threats. Lord, we pray for your peace. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for the victims worldwide suffering from the effects of climate change, from famine, droughts, floods. And today we pray especially for the people of Seoul, South Korea, as they cope with the loss of life in the recent street crush. Lord, hear us.
Lord,
we pray for those in our community going through difficult times, for the lonely, the homeless, and the depressed, the needy in so many different ways.
repay for the sick, for those who have asked for our prayers, those recovering, and those who feel unloved and uncared for. Lift our spirits with the bright light of hope. Father, encircle them and all of us with healing, sharing love, and friendly companionship. Lord, hear us. And Lord, surround with your loving presence those grieving the death of loved ones. Warm our hearts, Lord, with the memories of past joys, and surround us with the enduring faith and trust in the new life we have in our risen Lord Jesus Christ. In a moment of silence, we bring individual prayers to the Lord. Thank you, Father. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you please stand for the peace? We are fellow citizens with the saints and the household of God through Christ our Lord, who came and preached peace to those who were far off and those who were near. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us share with one another a sign of peace.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Okay.
Thank you.
let us present our offerings to the Lord. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty, for everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
We do indeed give you our thanks and praise, O God, for by your great power you have called us to a rich hope and pledged us a glorious inheritance among the saints. At creation's dawn, you sent the wind to stir up the sea of chaos and bring forth the earth. Through your law and prophets, you promised us that your kingdom would belong forever to those who embraced your holiness. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, you proclaimed a day when the hungry will feast and the mourners laugh. Through your Holy Spirit, you call us to new birth in a creation restored by love. As children of your redeeming purpose, we offer you our praise with angels and archangels and the whole company of heaven, singing the hymn of your unending glory. Glory and thanksgiving be to you, most loving Father, for the gift of your Son, born in human flesh. He is the Word existing beyond time, both source and final purpose, bringing to wholeness all that is made. Obedient to your will, he died upon the cross. By your power, you raised him from the dead. He broke the bonds of evil and set your people free to be his body in the world. On the night when he was given up to death, knowing that his hour had come, having loved his own, he loved them to the end. At supper with his disciples, he took bread and offered you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body. It is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup. He offered you thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. It is poured out for you and for all that sins may be forgiven. Do this in remembrance of me."
Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. As our Savior taught us, we have confidence so to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. The Holy Communion is a foretaste of that great final banquet at the end of the age known as the Marriage Supper of the Lamb, when all the saints from every nation, every generation, will all be gathered together there forever to be with the Lord. And so take these gifts to remember that you are part of that great body of Christ, and feed upon him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is gracious.
His mercy endures forever.
Lord of heaven, in this Eucharist you have brought us near to an innumerable company of angels and to the spirits of the saints made perfect. As in this food of our earthly pilgrimage we have shared their fellowship, so may we come to share their joy in heaven through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Before our final hymn, we have banns of marriage, two to announce. I publish the banns of marriage between Jennifer May Warren of this parish and Mark Glasgow, also of this parish, and between Luke Edward Sweeney and Jessica Patricia Barnes, also of this parish. This is for the third time of asking, and if anyone knows any reason in law why they should not be married to each other, you are to declare it. We stand as we sing our closing hymn. May God, who kindled the fire of his love in the hearts of the saints, pour out on you the riches of his grace. May he give you joy in their fellowship and a share in their praises. May he strengthen you to follow them in the way of holiness and to come to the full radiance of glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.